Saturdays and 2 to 5 o'clock on a Sunday. Also happening today, book signing. Gareth Ewing's going to be in the town centre today at the bookshop in the High Street in East Grinstead. He's going to be there from 10 o'clock today onwards. Gareth Ewing's going to be signing copies of his brand new book, The Rainbow Orchid, it's called. It's another one of his novels featuring Julius Chancer, so definitely don't miss out on that one. Okay, it's 107 at Meridian FM. If you want to get in contact this morning...
Massive thank you to the brilliant Ian Turner for the past 3 hours of the Saturday morning breakfast show. I'm joined in the studio by Garen Ewing, going to be talking all about his new book, The Rainbow Orchid, and he's actually going to be going up to the bookshop at 11 for book signing, so do pop along and meet Garen there. Saturday mornings on 107 Meridian FM, sponsored by Brilliant Eurythmics, and There Must Be an Angel Playing with My Heart. Good morning, Garen.
Good morning, Chris.
Great to have you on the show, and welcome to 107 Meridian FM.
Oh, thank you very much for having me.
You're very welcome. You've got a big day today, haven't you?
Yes. I'm signing at the bookshop on the High Street. I'll be there from 11 till 1.
Marvellous. And tell me a little bit about your book, because it is a book with a difference. It's not just a novel or anything like that. It is The Rainbow Orchid, and it's volume 3. So this is the third episode in this series of books,
right.
And it's The Adventures of Julius Chancer. Tell me a little bit about it, Ewan, because I've been looking through this, and it's a comic book.
Yes, what some people might call a graphic novel these days, anyway. And yes, it's a three-volume adventure. It's set in the 1920s.
Uh-huh.
It's basically... someone described it as Indiana Jones meets Tintin, which I think is a really nice shorthand way, so I use that. It's basically about the search for a mythical orchid flower that they takes them from England. They go to France and they travel to the Hindu Kush in India to a lost city in volume 3, which is this book.
So it's like looking for the Holy Grail, basically.
Yes, it is.
Oh my goodness, this is absolutely fantastic. So what was your inspiration? Was it Indiana Jones? Was it Tintin? And also, you know, you've just been telling me you do all your own illustrations.
Yes.
So I need to know your origins. I mean, go way back, Garen.
Well, it does go way back, really. Right back when I was a child, I was in hospital quite a lot for various operations. And to keep me occupied, my mum gave me pencils and comics, which was a sort of deadly combination, because what else could I end up doing but making my own comics? And Tintin and Asterix were the first comics I read.
Oh, I love Asterix.
Yes. It's brilliant stuff, yes.
Yeah.
And that's, I think, whatever you're given as a child can stay with you quite a lot, so it made a big impression. And I've been drawing comics ever since. And then a few years ago, I actually started The Rainbow Orchid in 1996, quite a long time ago. But it was picked up by a publisher in 2009. In fact, Egmont, who published Tintin, so I've come full circle in a way. I'm with the publisher who published my favourite comic as a child.
Oh, that's
wonderful.
Marvellous. So what did you do? Did you just send it off to Egmont?
No, actually, I self-published the first volume, mm-hmm. and that did really well. And then I didn't have the funds to publish a second volume, so I put it online as a sort of what some people call a web comic. And a publisher came to me through the internet, and through that, I'll do the short version, through that I got an agent, and then through the agent it went out to various publishers, and Egmont were one of them. It went to 10 publishers, and Egmont had already been aware of it because the commissioning editor there, who does Tintin, was aware of The Rainbow Orchid, and basically they picked it up from there. So I was really lucky, really.
Oh, absolutely fantastic. So basically, you do all your own illustrations, you write the story, you do everything.
Yes, even down to the... I designed the title on the cover, the font used for the lettering is my own hand lettering designed font. Egmont have got a wonderful team with the editor and a designer, and various publicity and marketing people, of course, which are the sort of vital ingredient to get it out there.
And what about the storyline? Because obviously, do they, tweak it a little bit or things like that, or do they leave it largely up to you as to where it goes?
Egmont has been very good in sort of leaving me to my own devices. It's mainly been, the editorial process has mainly been, where does a comma go and that kind of thing.
That's nice.
Yes.
Oh, that's very, very good news, because sometimes they can tweak and twiddle a bit
too
much.
Yes, if it's a good idea, that would be fine. Yeah, I'd be all for it.
Oh, smashing. Well, I want to come back and ask you more questions about this after this one. It is Flo Rida and Club Can't Handle Me. 16 minutes past 10 here on 107 Meridian FM. Good morning. I'm Chris O'Brien, joined in the studio by Garen Ewing. And we are talking all about the Rainbow Orchid Volume 3. More about that after this. Brilliant, Jessie J and Domino. Now, Garen, tell me your history. I mean, you did go to art college. I mean, looking at your illustrations, there's no doubting your amazing talent and ability and your vibrancy of colours and everything. And, you know, you can just read the story just by looking at the pictures.
Oh, yes, thank you very much, yeah.
So, what happened?
Well, I did go to art college, but only for 6 months. I went to Crawley Technical College, actually. I was rejected from the first art college I went to because the tutor thought I'd copied all my work. But actually, it was just because I loved drawing comics. I had a very commercial style. So for someone who was aged 16 or 17 at the time, I think he thought it was, I mean, it wasn't great drawing, but it was commercial style. So I was rejected there, went to Crawley Technical College, but really it was a very general art course, and I had to do all kinds of things like photography, pottery, things I knew I didn't want to do. I always wanted to do comics, and so I just dropped out of lack of interest, really, and got on with the commercial art aspect.
Fantastic. So, do you know, this often happens in life, doesn't it? You know, when things don't go well, it's almost like a crossroads, a turning point, and it pushes you in a certain direction. And you have to follow your heart. You've got to listen to what's inside.
Yes, I think that's really important. If you're not doing something, if you're doing something you don't enjoy, it can be very difficult. And really, I can't imagine doing anything else. Now, I have had jobs. I've worked at a hotel. I worked at the mushroom farm, but always drawing alongside. And the Rainbow Orchid itself was done in the evenings to begin with, until it got picked up. Only the last couple of years I've done it full-time, comics.
So when you were rejected, going back to art college, yes. You know, you were rejected all those years ago, and you were really accused of plagiarism, really.
Well, I guess I was, yes. I never thought of it that way. Now I'm annoyed.
What did you do? Did you think, oh, you know, I must go and get a normal job and everything. I've got no future in this.
I, to be honest, I don't remember. I don't remember feeling too rejected. I think I knew there'd be other options. I actually signed up for the course at Crawley College and was rejected for that as well, now I think about it. So I signed up for a part-time graphics course, and then when I went to sign up for that, I was told, oh, there is a space on the general art course. In hindsight, I probably would have been better with the graphics course. It was more my kind of thing.
A lot of artists do go that way as well.
Yes, yeah.
Yes.
It was all good experience. And I was at the Bath Festival a couple of years ago with Dave McKean, the illustrator. And there was him saying, someone said, oh, is it good to go to art college? This is a question I get a lot at kids' events, and I do always think, well, I didn't, but you don't want to discourage kids from getting an education, of course. And Dave McKean actually said he loved art college. He was taught a variety of things. For instance, I can't paint. I do have a fairly limited skill set, which luckily has done me okay. But I do see the benefits of going to college and getting a wide variety of skills there.
Of course. So if you can't paint, what material do you actually use to colour in your illustrations?
Well, I draw it all on Bristol board with pencil and then Indian ink with a dip pen. That's scanned into the computer, and I colour it on the computer, actually. And because it's, if you know the Tintin books, it's like that. There's quite a lot of panels on the page. It's quite detailed, so I use very flat colours just to keep it fairly graphically simple.
Absolutely. So what comes first, the illustrations or the bubbles, you know, the speech bubbles? Because I think this is every child's dream. I remember drawing comics myself when I was little. I think comics are so, so special.
Yes.
And I know they're massive in China and Japan and everything,
yes,
aren't they?
Yeah.
Do you go international as well? Do you send yours overseas?
Yes, I've. There's a Dutch edition. I've just been to Holland for the launch of Volume 3 a couple of weeks ago. The Europeans absolutely love their comics.
Yeah.
And they love these kind of comics as well. In this country, we only really know Tintin in this style. In Europe, there's a lot of stuff in this sort of clear line style. I was going to announce this on my blog on Monday, but I've actually just signed a contract for a Spanish edition.
Fantastic.
So that's a new thing. And I've got another one, which I've signed the contract, but I won't go into detail yet. So there's European editions coming out.
Wonderful.
Certainly.
So going back to my original question.
Yes, well, as for the writing, first of all, I write the script freehand, and then I type it up as a second draft. So the script is done first alongside kind of rough sketches, to work out where the characters go and to make sure the balloons will go in the right order, which is important.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
And then I actually do another page of roughs to put the lettering on so I know how much space they take up. And then that's basically it. Then I start the actual drawing.
It's absolutely fantastic. It's a lot like a storyboard, creating a storyboard, isn't it, for a television commercial or something like
that?
Yeah, very
much so.
The same process, I suppose, really.
Yeah.
That's absolutely fantastic. I'm going to be coming back to you after this one now. This is one of your choices.
Yes.
It is a brilliant queen, and we think this is a very appropriate one, don't we?
Yes.
Because we both loved watching Flash Gordon on a Saturday morning.
And he came from comics as well, the character, so perfect.
Precisely. It is Queen and Flash. Just for you here on 107 Meridian FM, 10:30. Hope you're having a really good morning already. I'm joined by Garen Ewing. And that is the brilliant Beatles and Twist and Shout. Now, Garen, these stories, your storyline, where does it come from? Do the characters take on a life of their own? Because they're such real characters in here. You know, they're so beautifully illustrated, and you must know these characters, their features and everything in depth, obviously.
Yes.
And you must have a friendship with these characters as well. Now, do they take you along the storyline? Do they write the story for you?
I think they might do in a way. I mean, the first thing I started with were the two main characters. So Julius Chancer is the main character, but the other main character is called Lily Lawrence, and she's, I said it was set in the 1920s, she's a silent film star, and they both go on this big adventure together. And I started by sketching them to try and get the right look. And my love of this kind of adventure comes from sort of Rider Haggard, Jules Verne, Arthur Conan Doyle type Lost World adventures, you know, like Journey to the Centre of the Earth and King Solomon's Mines type of stuff.
Oh, yeah.
So that coupled with the Tintin style, graphic style, is basically, I just want to do everything I loved to put into a story, because comics take so long to do. I thought, I've got to do something I enjoy. But anyway, back to the characters. They did develop it. Julius Chancer is a bit of a blank canvas, actually, as the main. He's surrounded by a lot of, I think, and people have said, quite interesting characters, but he himself is a little bit of a mannequin in some ways. So halfway through, I decided that he needed a little bit of character injecting into him, rather than just being the central hub of events. So I sort of injected a bit of doubt into him. So he has a bit of a wobble halfway through the adventure, which actually coloured him up a bit and made him a bit more interesting.
And more human as well, because everybody has a wobble, no matter...
Oh, other, definitely,
you know.
Yes.
Yeah, unless you're James Bond, but even he is having wobbles these days.
Yes, it's the modern thing.
It certainly is. But that's fascinating, because you can fall in love with these characters as well, I think. You know, especially when you draw them, because you know their features, you know everything about them, and they are family members, they are friends,
Yes, and with a comic, of course, you're drawing them so many times. And actually, if you look at them in Volume 1 at the beginning, they're quite different to the way I draw them later on. And I think it may take something like, I'm putting this number out of the air, but 100 drawings of a character before you really feel comfortable drawing them naturally. You know what I mean?
I do know what you mean. So in a situation, you know, you've got your characters here, and Julius is going to do a grimace or something like that. Do you know exactly the way he's going to grimace? Do you know his characteristics so well now that you know exactly which way his mouth will turn if he does a grimace? Do they have little, you know, ticks and things like
that? Yes. I mean, being a fairly simple cartooning style, so they've got dots for eyes, although the actual proportions are not so cartoony, you don't have many lines to work with, really. So Julius Chancer, his defining features graphically are his eyebrows. Someone said they were Art Deco eyebrows, and his hairstyle. But yes, on the cover of Volume 3 is his main adversary called Evelyn Crow, and she's a lot of people's favourite character. And she's quite striking looking with her sort of 1920s bob, a bit like Louise Brooks, the silent film actress, that kind of look. So they've all got one or two defining features just to make them stand out.
Absolutely, and to make them very attractive as well. Absolutely gorgeous. But what a lovely combination. You're combining adventure, your sense of adventure.
Yes.
Who doesn't love adventure?
Oh, yes.
I'm right there with you. You're going into these massive, you know, like you say, Indiana Jones sort of adventures and things, and just going places where you don't normally get to go and doing things which are absolutely remarkable.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not a very good traveller. I'm a little bit nervous about it. So this gives me the opportunity to go and do it from the safety of my drawing board.
And what a way to live your life. That is absolutely marvellous. I want to talk to you more about that after this one. It is Example and Kickstarts. Just for you here on 107 Meridian FM. Good morning, I'm Chris, joined in the studio by Garen Ewing. We're talking all about Volume 3 of The Rainbow Orchid, The Adventures of Julius Chancer. You want me to call this train and drive by. Now, Garen, you don't only work on the Rainbow Orchid, do you? You
nope.
do other work for comics and things like that and illustrations. How else do you earn your money?
Well, I went self-employed in about 2002 doing illustrations for book covers, magazines, all kinds of stuff, actually. But comics I've been doing have kept me busy full-time for almost the last 2 years, doing Rainbow Orchid, but also doing something for a new children's weekly called The Phoenix, which is doing really well. It's I think you can buy it in Waitrose, in East Grinstead, actually. It's subscription mainly, but it is in Waitrose, and there is a Waitrose in East Grinstead, isn't there?
There is,
So it should be in there. I think I've seen it in there. At the moment, I've got a strip in there written by someone else. It's called The Bald Boy and the Dervish, and it's a kind of Arabian Nights adventure story. It's a four-part thing. Part three came out this week, part four, the last part's coming out next week. But it's really good, and whenever I go and do workshops for children, either at a bookshop or schools, and I always ask them what comics they read, and I'm getting more hands up for The Phoenix, so that's really nice to see.
Oh, fantastic. Everybody loves a good comic, don't they?
Yes, yes.
Really, really brilliant. And you can learn an awful lot from comics, you know, social interaction and everything from these characters who come alive on the page, and you can see them, and there's nothing like just reading the speech bubbles.
No, I think that's the great thing about a comic, is you can open it at the first page, and the drawing brings you into the story straight away. And before you know it, you're reading the first panel, then the second panel, and then you're halfway through the book because you get drawn into it.
Of course, absolutely. And aren't you just... And you remember the characters so well as well because they're vividly drawn there.
Oh, yes,
so, you know,
yes.
It's brilliant. But what I love about the Rainbow Orchid, Garen, is that you have got this sort of character list as you open the book, so you know exactly what characters are there.
Yes, yes. There's a lot of characters in the Rainbow Orchid. The main character is Julius Chancer, but as I said, there's a kind of it's a sort of ensemble piece, really. I thought it'd be a good idea at the front of the book to do a page of all the characters, so you can always refer to them if you get a bit confused, which hopefully you won't. They're all quite distinctive and memorable in their way.
I think that is absolutely brilliant. And not only that, but the next page, you've got the Rainbow Orchid, the story so far.
Yes.
So you can actually come into Volume 3 without, first of all, reading
Volume
1 or 2, but it's nice then to go back to Volume 1 or 2 as well, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. I would say so.
But that is so useful to have that little précis there.
Yes, they're quite difficult to write, these little stories so far, because you have to leave stuff out, of course.
Precisely, you do. I'm going to have to do that in the second hour of my show, because I'm doing a serialisation of Alice in Wonderland.
Oh, right.
And I've been so busy over the past few weeks that we've had a little bit of a break, so I'm going to have to, you know, just remind everybody about the story so far, and that's going to be very difficult, actually.
Yes,
to,
good luck.
You know, thank you very much. Now, you are going to be doing the book signing at the bookshop on the High Street,
yes.
John Pipes, the book bookshop. It's a gorgeous Tudor bookshop.
It's lovely, yes.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
That is just such a beautiful, inspirational place as well. Not many independent bookshops are still alive.
No, and John's been absolutely fantastic supporting the Rainbow Orchid. Right from the beginning, I had my local book launch there. I had one in Foyles in London, but actually more people came to the East Grinstead one than Foyles, which was nice, but the East Grinstead one is the one I remember.
I know exactly what you mean. John gives you the personal touch, doesn't
absolutely
he?
Absolutely,
and he's just absolutely brilliant. He's been absolutely brilliant with us, with the Meridian FM radio book club as well, and we do some brilliant authors. And it's thanks to John and the bookshop. You know, he's just really brilliant.
Yes.
Yeah, superb. So you will be doing the book signing from 11 o'clock at the bookshop on the High Street.
That's right.
Marvellous. And what's your website, Garen?
I've got a website with full of lovely stuff. It's rainboworchid.co.uk.
Marvellous. So if anybody wants to go and see your blogs or what you've been doing today...
Yes, and a preview of the comic as well.
Marvellous. Give us that contact detail again, that website detail.
Okay, so it's rainboworchid.co.uk.
That's absolutely brilliant. Well, it's been absolutely fantastic having you on my show. And unless you can stay around till 11, I don't know. Do you need to get up there?
I could probably have another 5 minutes.
Stay exactly where you are, then. We will have this one very quickly. It is Alicia Keys and Empire State of Mind, just for you, here on 107 Meridian FM, 9 minutes to 11. Hope you're having a really good morning already. I'm joined in the studio by Garen Ewing. We've been talking all about The Rainbow Orchid, Volume 3, The Adventures of Julius Chancer. Garen's going to be popping up to the bookshop in East Grinstead on the High Street very shortly to do a book signing at 11. Make sure you're there. By Alicia Keys. Now, Garen, you are an East Grinstead lad, aren't you?
I am, yes. I've lived here, most of my life. 40 years.
Oh, my goodness.
Yes.
Oh, gosh. So where were you born?
I was actually born in Redhill.
Right.
And then my parents moved. Their first house was in Dormansland. Then they went to Reading, where my brother was born. Then they came back when he was about one or something to East Grinstead.
Marvellous. It's certainly got a pull, has East Grinstead. We never meant to live here for so long. We're still here many years later.
Stuck here, but it's lovely. And in fact, in Volume 1 of The Rainbow Orchid, I do have a little East Grinstead scene. From the top of the High Street, I used part of the High Street in the background there.
Oh, how lovely is that?
Yes.
I'm going to have to go and have a look at that.
Yes, sorry, I've run out of Volume 1s at home, so come to the bookshop, and I think hopefully
Definitely.
John has plenty there.
Oh, that would be absolutely fantastic. How lovely is that to add a local, element to it? That is smashing. So like us with the radio plays, I'm wanting to introduce local shops and things into our little radio plays, because we're going to be airing our first radio play very shortly here on 107 Meridian FM. But this is just brilliant, absolutely brilliant.
Thank you.
Very much looking forward to going home and sitting down and getting myself lost in this adventure.
Yes, a cup of tea and a biscuit are also essential ingredients for reading a comic.
I absolutely agree with you. That is really superb. Well, I hope you have a fantastic time today.
Thank you.
And good luck with the book signing bookshop. And I will see you very, very soon. And do keep in touch with
you. I will do. Thank you so much for having me. I've really enjoyed it.
I've really enjoyed having your company too. And are you on Volume 4 now?
There's a new Julius Chancer adventure. I'm writing the synopsis on Monday for my publisher.
Marvellous. That would be fantastic. And he'll say yes or no. And
I hope he'll say yes.
Otherwise, it's back to the drawing board, literally.
Yes, indeed.
Thank you so much for coming into the studio this morning, Garen.
Thank you.
Good luck with the Rainbow Orchid. It's absolutely fantastic. And good luck with the book signing up at the bookshop today.
Thank you very much.
And I'm going to be taking you into the news now with this one. It is Rihanna. And Where Have You Been? I've been everywhere.